Good afternoon, good morning, good evening. My name is Sandra Galea. I have the privilege of serving as Dean of the Boston University School of Public Health. On behalf of our school, welcome to this public health conversation. By way of identification, I'm a middle-aged man with olive skin and dark hair. I wear glasses. I'm wearing a black suit and a blue shirt, and I'm sitting in front of a white wall. Throughout the year, we come together at these events to discuss the issues that matter most for health. We welcome speakers who guide our discussion on these issues. Through a process of engagement and debate, we work towards a better understanding of the ideas that shape a healthier world. Thank you for joining us for today's event. These events are the work of many. I want to offer thanks to the Dean's Office and the marketing and communications teams, without whose efforts none of these conversations would take place. Public health, at its best, advances a vision of a world that generates health for all. We have, as a field, made much progress towards this world. However, there remain areas where we are still far from where we should be. One of these areas is our engagement with disability. In the US, more than a quarter of adults live with some form of disability. We have not, however, created a country or a world that is optimized for supporting the health of all who live with disability. Instead, we have mostly worked at the margins to accommodate people living with disability without fundamentally shaping a world designed with disability in mind. Today's conversation is meant to help bring a vision of such a world into focus. It is fitting that we should have this conversation before the International Day of Persons with Disabilities on December 3rd, a time for coming together to advance progress on how we address disability and support those living with it. I look forward to learning from all our speakers as we work towards a new paradigm about public health engagement with disability. I'm now pleased to introduce Eric Rubenstein, moderator of the first part of today's event. Dr. Rubenstein is an assistant professor of epidemiology at the Boston University School of Public Health. His work is focused on improving the lives of individuals living with intellectual and developmental disabilities, including Down syndrome and autism spectrum disorder. Dr. Rubenstein, over to you.
Thank you, Dean Galea, for that introduction. I am a 32-year-old man with a brown beard and brown hair, wearing a blue button-up shirt, sitting at an office desk with a large picture of Massachusetts over my left shoulder. It is my pleasure to be moderating the keynote discussion today. I'd like to introduce our keynote speaker, Ms. Judy Heumann. I'm going to pick up this sheet to read from because the resume is so impressive. I don't want to get anything wrong. Ms. Heumann is a lifelong advocate for the rights of disabled people, and she has been instrumental in the development and implementation of legislation, such as Section 504, the Individuals with Education Act, the Americans with Disabilities Act, the Rehabilitation Act, and the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. Ms. Heumann produces a podcast called The Heumann Perspective, which features a variety of members from the disability community, and she serves on a number of nonprofit boards, including the American Association of People with Disabilities, the Disability Rights Education and Defense Fund, Humanity and Inclusion, Human Rights Watch, United States International Council on Disability, and Save the Children. Ms. Heumann has 20 years of nonprofit experience working with various disability organizations, including being a founding member of the Berkeley Center for Independent Living. Prior to starting the Judith Heumann LLC, she served in the Clinton administration and Obama administrations. Before we begin our discussion, Ms. Heumann has asked us to play the trailer for the Oscar-nominated documentary Crip Camp, A Disability Revolution.
Wait, you want me to tell them what happened? Well, two people got cramps and they're spinning.
We were all very hyper about it.
And I have to go shower some people. I'll see you later.
I wanted to be part of the world, but I didn't see anyone like me in it.
I hear about a summer camp for the handicapped run by hippies. Somebody said you probably will smoke dope with the counselors, and I'm like, sign me up.
Up to Camp Janet and find yourself.
There I was in Woodstock.
You wouldn't be picked to be on the team back home, but at Jeanette, you had to go up the bat.
Even when we were that young, we helped empower each other. It was allowing us to recognize that the status quo is not what it needed to be.
The world always wants us dead. We live with that reality.
At the time, so many kids just like me were being sent to institutions. It was just a continual struggle.
Most disabled people, like myself, are unable to use public transportation.
We needed a civil rights law of our own.
A rehabilitation program has been vetoed by the president because it was cost prohibitive.
We decided we were going to have a demonstration.
You get the call to action, to the barricades.
A small army of the handicapped have occupied this building for the past 11 days.
So many people from Camp Jeanette found their way into the building.
The FBI cut off the phones. The deaf people went, we know what to do. That's how we communicated to the people outside the building. The Black Panther Party would bring a hot meal. We were like this.
We are the strongest political force in this country.
We will no longer allow the government to oppress disabled individuals. And I would appreciate it if you would stop shaking your head in agreement when I don't think you understand what we are talking about.
What we saw at that camp was that our lives could be better.
If you don't demand what you believe in for yourself, you're not gonna get it.
I said for pleasure.
Do you like to see the handicapped people depicted as people?
Excuse me?
Ms. Heumann, thank you for joining us. I think you're still on mute.
Sorry, thank you. Let me give a quick visual description. I am almost a 75-year-old disabled woman. I'm like, you're almost 32. And I am in the apartment of my husband and myself. I also have my company here. And I am wearing blue glasses and a blue jacket with a light green trim in the foyer of our apartment, which has all types of photos and other plants. And I'm in Washington, D.C.
Well, thank you so much for joining us today. We really appreciate you sharing with us and talking with us. So I first want to put in a plug for your book. If we were in person today, we would have an Oprah style look under your seat below and you would get the book. It's really fantastic. I highly recommend it. And in the book, you talk about sort of how you got involved in public health, being that that's sort of what we're thinking about today. If you can tell us about the scenario and how you got involved in an MPH program and how that training has sort of impacted your career and your trajectory.
Well, I will very briefly explain that in 1973, I'd been accepted to Columbia University. I was supposed to go and get a degree in community organizing. And then I was teaching in Brooklyn after my lawsuit. I was teaching second grade. And then I got a call one day from a gentleman named Ed Roberts, who I had never heard of before. Today, you know, he's recognized as father of the independent living movement. He was one of the founders of the CIL in Berkeley. And he said, one, they were interested in bringing disabled people to Berkeley to learn about CIL and to be able to come out, go to graduate school. And there were two professors that were interested in bringing some more disabled students in. One was city and regional planning. One was public health. So I applied to public health, but honestly, in 1973, I didn't know what public health was. And I'm very, very glad that that's the degree that I got. My professor was a gentleman named Henrik Blum, who, I mean, just the very fact that he was interested in bringing disabled people into the MPH program at that time, I think really indicated that he was very open and receptive to looking at who the community is that public health needs to be addressing. For me, though, it was also very much that he legitimized my vision of things. He legitimized for me that I wanted to be working in a way that was bringing people together, disabled people with all types of disabilities from all backgrounds, but also that it was very important to be influencing public policies, laws, educating people about what their rights were and not just working in an area. And I think that was probably one of the most important parts of my going to graduate school at Berkeley, is that I had a great mentor. He got me onto the board of an organization called the Over 60s Health Clinic, which allowed me to then start also doing work in the area of aging and disability. So my sphere of interest and influence began to expand. And I'm really glad that I got my MPH. I don't think I would have been very happy in city and regional planning, although it is clearly an area of great importance.
Yeah, and sort of seeing your work throughout your career and sort of reading your book, kind of the importance of thinking about structural determinants that I think is such a key component of public health is really kind of how you've sort of launched your movement, not your movement, but the movement that you've been a part of all these years. How does sort of that thinking, the structural thinking, influence how you have seen sort of changes in disability rights over over the years?
I would say that it's a very relevant question, and I'll have an answer, and then others thinking about this and their views is very important. One of the issues for me is how do we make meaningful change in the minds of others than those with disabilities about where the inherent problems exist for disabled people in our systems, whatever system you're working in. Because I think it's fair to say that there is no system that we could say is an exemplar of showing how it has removed the myriad of barriers that exist to getting our very diverse community of disabled people equal entry, equal access, equal benefit. And I think public health itself could be doing work that really was able to analyze what needs to be done to get people to see where the obvious areas of neglect exist. And in the case of disability, it's not unique to disability, but people's views of who we are not. I believe that, you know, many people view us as not being capable, as not being able to benefit from, contribute to, that those biases are very significant. And even as, like with all the speakers you have today, very clear, there are many people in our country and countries around the world who have great expertise. People will still look at, well, you're an exception. They may not say that, but you know that's what they're thinking. You know that leadership at tables does not all too often include someone who can be a strong, knowledgeable advocate on how to put what I call a disability lens on whatever work is being done and how to break that chain. I mean, I'm a very strong believer in strong laws and implementation, that it's laws that bring about requirements of change that over time impact people on race or gender or disability, whatever the theme may be. But things are just taking so long. I think in the area of disability, part of it is, and this is not really bad, part of it is that there are more and more categories of people that are being identified as having a disability. So, you know, when I was growing up, learning disabilities, autism, et cetera, those really were not yet identified. We were not identifying people and the kinds of support and assistance that they may have needed in school and careers. So you have this ever-changing world, but on the other hand, it's still this fundamental issue of believing that there are the haves and have-nots. Disabled people are more often, regardless of disability, in the have-nots category. But then if you coupled it with types of disability, racial background, sexual orientation, et cetera, immigrant status, that also can have a very strong influence on not believing that people can make and must see this as an essential part of their work. As you said, you know, we're looking at like 61, 65 million disabled people in the United States. It's a huge number of people that are completely or partially being excluded in many important ways in society.
Yeah, so I'm an epidemiologist, so I do a lot of thinking about how we define disability for public health, for measuring huge administrative systems like Medicaid or Medicare. And, you know, you're right that there are a ton of disabilities that were once not considered a disability or not part of the label, but sort of the underlying stigmas and disparities, the root cause is the same, right? It's not specific to the condition in and of itself. It's sort of those structural things that we need to change. And kind of on that point, there's a lot to do. There's really so much that has been done and still needs to be done. How do you talk to your trainees, your mentees, about sort of burnout? You've kind of had a long, sustained career, and you're still in it, which is amazing, being that I've been in this for less than 10 years and I'm already burnt out. So what do you tell to people when they're, you know, sort of hit the frustrations of working for change and not seeing results right away?
For me, it's recognizing that if change came about so easily, we wouldn't be where we are today. And people need to be, I mean, I'm in this because I have a disability. I'm in this because I have a disability and I'm a woman. I'm in this because I have a disability, I'm a woman, and I'm Jewish. All these different categories are areas where discrimination exists. And I have never known how to kind of separate me from wanting to make change. I mean, that change is very important to me. So I think, you know, when I first went out to Berkeley as their deputy, because I went to graduate school, came to Washington, DC, worked in a senator's office for a year and a half, and then went back to Berkeley and became the deputy at the Berkeley CIO. And that first year I worked 7 days a week, like 8 to 10 hours a day. And at the end of the first year, I really knew I couldn't continue to work that way. So I didn't go into the office on Saturday or Sunday, but I work. I don't work all the time, but I think if, you know, you need to know your body, you need to know when you need a break. You also need to sometimes vary the work that you're doing and, you know, move into another aspect of the work where you feel more accomplished, or really try to analyze what is making you feel burned out. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it may mean you have to take a couple of months off in order to really, but at the end of the day, for me, as I've said, I am a disabled woman. And that is who I am. And so if I cut myself out of looking at change that needs to be made, I don't think I could live with myself. But I want to be really clear that there are times when I feel tired, or like that first year at CIL, definitely concerned about burning out and needing to look at what to do.
Yeah, thank you for that answer. I can definitely take some of that advice. So I'm going to ask one more question, and then we'll open it up to the floor for some Q&A. So in reading your book, there kind of was a lot of instances in your life that we are still relevant to today, or especially relevant today. So for an example, you talk about the lawsuit against the airlines where they wouldn't let you fly by yourself. Airlines have consistently destroyed wheelchairs. It's still in the news. I think that there might be some move to some policy now to change that. You mentioned in your book about how one of the judges that was proceeding in a case was a leader in the abortion decisions and sort of you know, it seems like a lot of the issues that you've seen in the past are still relevant today. So what would you tell the larger public health community to push us towards justice on some of these issues that are really kind of longstanding? We've made some progress, but there's still more to do.
You know, there are many positive things that I think have happened over the years, but one of them is, again, when I was, you know, in my teens and 20s, I kind of described what was going on as, you know, go into a candy store and pick any one of your favorite candies. Something needed to be done in that area to address disability and discrimination. We were not specialists at that point. But I think what is out of necessity, and I think it's very important, more disabled people are becoming experts in different areas. And, you know, for example, when we were fighting for accessible transportation, most of the people who were involved with that were not engineers, didn't know anything about how to make a bus accessible. So it became really important that we not only have people who agreed and supported this work, that some of them have disabilities, but that we were also going to be able to make appropriate arguments for why this was important. So specialists in transportation and housing, healthcare and education, I think have been two of the areas that have been really slow. Section 504 of the Rehabilitation Act, which Crip Camp later on goes to discuss in greater detail, I would say that Section 504 prior to the ADA was very influential in being able to begin to get more disabled people into the health field, into the public health field. Because prior to that, seeing a disabled person, an out disabled person, being able to get into a medical school was very limited. And you really began to see in the late 70s, early 80s, how there were more disabled people who were qualified to go to medical school, as an example, and could no longer be denied because of disability, because it was illegal. So these laws, I think, you know, we now have a larger pool of disabled individuals in nursing, in as doctors, in public health. I mean, I've seen a really interesting advancement of more disabled people going into public health as a field, either for bachelor's or master's or PhDs. That is all important because people with these areas of knowledge and expertise should be being brought to the table and being able to really help look at what are the barriers, what are the solutions, what is not happening. I mean, I do a lot of talks with companies, and it really still astounds me that people are regularly asking a question of how do I talk to somebody? At that very fundamental level of how do I have a meaningful discussion? So if people are afraid of speaking to someone who has a disability, then really being able to make the changes that need to happen have to be discussed internally. And you know, at a university, for example, we know that there are many universities that although they've been required to comply with Section 504 since 1973, are still not in compliance. And I hear on a regular basis from disabled students and faculty biases that exist on their campuses, reports that chancellors and presidents have put together on diversity, equity, and inclusion, in some cases accessibility, that either completely ignore the disability issue or really do not significantly address it, or other students and faculty feeling that they're not really being included. Now, those are signs that things need to change. And there needs to be a willingness and an openness to listen to what people are saying and to feel responsible and to look at accountability as something which is essential.
Thank you so much. That was a tremendous answer. I'm gonna start moving into the questions from the audience. So if you have a question, we'll take about 10 minutes for questions here. So please put them in the Q&A. So I'm gonna sort of riff on this question from an anonymous attendee who was asking about sort of housing models. And we know there's been a big shift away from the institutional model to more of a group home, community inclusion, independent living model. What do you see as sort of the current status of housing and how we as advocates, allies, disabled people can push for more equitable housing? I know I do a little bit of work in home and community-based service waivers. Are there any other things that you know of that sort of can push towards more equitable and fair housing?
Enforcement of the law. And we're not just looking at disabled people, although a disproportionate number of homeless people have various forms of disabilities. Being able to get vouchers into people's hands, ensuring that those vouchers are being accepted by landlords, not only helping people get into housing, but providing them the support they need to be successful in the housing, ensuring that if they need benefits, there can be assisted in getting those benefits. Home and community-based services, you know, for someone like myself who uses a motorized wheelchair, that really limits the stock available that someone who's a wheelchair user or not easily able to ambulate up and down steps can use. So housing shortages and the amount of money that people are having to spend for rental units or purchasing property are very significant. I think the disability community is and needs to continue to be more strongly involved in what's going on in housing movements in local communities. But also, I think, gets back to something I was discussing earlier, needing to help people have an understanding of who the population of disabled people are in order to remove some of the biases that exist about facilitating people being able to get into the housing market. But at the end of the day, it's a crisis of what's going on. Litigation in LA, where LA lost. There's litigation going on in Chicago, similar to the litigation that went on in LA. And in both of those cases, you clearly see that the cities were well aware of what they needed to be doing. But housing stock was not being made accessible. Housing stock that was accessible was not being utilized for individuals who needed it. And that local disability rights organizations were having to spend disproportionate amounts of time on this issue because local and state governments were not doing their job.
Yeah, thank you for that answer. So Josh Gladstone has a question that I think is pretty relevant to your book. So he asks, how hard has coalition building been with disability activism? Where do you think the next steps in this area are, or where it is lacking most? And I think that in your book, you do a really nice job telling the story, especially in the 504 protests of sort of the team of with the Black Panthers and the Salvation Army and all of those local San Francisco organizations. How do you coalition build, and what advice do you have for public health professionals or really anyone on this webinar here about that process?
I think for public health professionals, what I say all the time is put a disability lens on your work, whatever it is. And that means when looking at coalition development, public health frequently are bringing players to the table. Who are the players that you're bringing? Are they including disabled people who are professionals in the area? Are they including local disability rights organizations that are knowledgeable about issues in the community? Are you going out into the community and really learning in a very meaningful way what the barriers are that people are facing? I'm going to give an example, which is not a US example, but is in many ways. There was a program in Ethiopia that was open to help women be able to get loans from the government to set up businesses. Any woman who was seen as having a disability wouldn't even be given a form. So they had to start a separate program to help disabled women be able to get into this program. Now that's a very stark example. Here we have many of the same things. If you look at COVID and the policies that were originally being put forth on COVID, where you know if you had a disability, you would be moved to the back of the line. If you used a ventilator, one originally was looking at being able to take a ventilator away from a ventilator user to give someone who previously hadn't used a ventilator and needed a ventilator to give them a ventilator. That to me is such a clear example of how the healthcare field has devalued the lives of disabled people. If you have an intellectual disability, if you have Down syndrome, if you may need a heart replacement or lung replacement because you have Down syndrome, and the obstacles that you may have to go forward with because you have Down syndrome over and over again. And it means that people need to be learning about disability rights, disability justice, from when they start school. Our universities, when I talk about this disability lens, every public health course should ensure that disability is included. And again, disability, there's so many types, and I'm not saying that we have to learn about every particular type, but we do need to look at disability and gender, and disability and gender and race. We need to be doing research which more clearly identifies the additional forms of discrimination that some people with disabilities are experiencing because of one issue or another. I think, you know, it would be, APHA has got its section on disability, which I think has been a reasonably active section. But a lot more needs to be done, and disability is not yet being integrated into university curricula and not in public health curricula either. And I think, you know, these articles that came out in November about doctors not wanting to see disabled people is a perfect example. I mean, the number of offices that I have been to where I ask where the wheelchair accessible scale is. Now, if weighing oneself is not important, then no office would have a scale. But I've never been to a doctor's office where they don't have a scale, or in a hospital where they don't have a scale, because there is an important factor in why you want to know somebody's weight, as a simple example. So simple things like that are not addressed. So when you get to more complex issues like coordinated healthcare, I think when you talked, Eric, about community home and community-based services, which is something that's so essential for a certain population or a certain number of us, people don't really understand what it is. And one of the reasons why I think it's so important that we're looking at home and community-based services is not just for those of us who need the service now, but for other people in the community to understand what it is, why it is important, what are effective models, what are the payment schemes, and get those people involved from a public health perspective in being able to get better home and community-based services, that people don't have to be looking at moving out into other places. Why is housing still being built with steps and doors that are too narrow and all types of things that make it very clear if you acquire a disability as you're getting older, you're not going to be able to stay living there.
Thank you so much. I'm going to take the last question, sort of inspired by a few different comments in the Q&A. But your story really begins with the education system. You know, sort of you were not perceived as less than until you went to public school and were not allowed equal opportunity. How do you see the state of public education now? And it's sort of, I think, kind of overlooked as a huge piece of public health, sort of quality education, where, you know, talking about structural changes, really that's where a lot can be done. Where do we stand in sort of education and how that links to health downstream?
Well, I think what you just said is so true. Failure to look at the effect of poor education on populations in this country, goes without saying, has a tremendous adverse effect on the individual and their family and their future ability to be successful in the community. I think as a society, and this really does relate to the comment that you made, we don't value education. Families are having fewer children. They don't enter the school building. They don't understand its relevance. And I think we really need to be allowing people to understand what disparities exist, for example, in poor and wealthier communities. We need people to understand the value of public education and what has been going on within the public education system in the United States. And now that we're discussing disabled people, really looking at what is going on in the area of education for disabled children and young adults. I think on the one hand, there are definite improvements that have gone on, but the improvements are nowhere where they need to be. There's still way too little education going on at the undergraduate and graduate level, which ensures that people coming in to study education are not just taking one course in disability, but that disability is integrated into the training that teachers are getting on how to teach math and English and and how to work in an inclusive environment, and how education really is the backbone of any country. And as we lose that more broadly, this is not a disability issue. This is a US issue, and one that we need to allow people to have a better understanding of data, because people aren't learning about data. What is data? What should the data look like? What should we take from the data? I mean, a weak public health system across the United States because people don't really understand what public health is, what the role of public health should be at the federal, state, and local level. And to me, it all relates back to education.
I think that that is the perfect call to action for us as public health professionals. Thank you for speaking with us, Judy. If this were a podcast, I'd give you your plugs here, but we have a great book, we have Crip Camp, we have a podcast. Really, please, we're so thrilled to have you here today.
Thank you.
Okay, so now I have the pleasure of introducing the moderator for the panel discussion, Mr. Eric Garcia. Mr. Garcia is the senior Washington correspondent for The Independent and a columnist for MSNBC. He is the author of the book, We're Not Broken, Changing the Autism Conversation and Autistic Himself. Previously, he was an assistant editor at the Washington Post Outlook section, an associate editor at The Hill, and a correspondent for the National Journal, Market Watch, and Roll Call. He has also written for The Daily Beast, The New Republic, and Salon.com. Mr. Garcia is a graduate of the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill and lives in Washington, D.C. Mr. Garcia, to you.
Thank you very much, Eric, from Eric, Dr. Rubenstein, for that introduction. It is my pleasure to be moderating today's panel discussion and also just to be even virtually in the same space as the GOAT, Judith Heumann. Judith, it's good to meet you. Good to see you again. So a couple of order of things. First, we are going to be hearing from Harvard College senior Ben Elwy, who is a disability advocate and writer. Ben is the co-founder of the Harvard Undergraduate Disability Justice Student Organization, which aims to combat ableism and inaccessibility through around campus and society through activism. They're also a contributing opinion writer for the Harvard Crimson and the author of the Living a Disabled Life column. Then we will hear from Ms. Reyma McCoy Hyten, CEO of the Special Public Benefit Limited Liability Company. Ms. McCoy Hyten is the first Black woman to ever serve on the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services Commissioner for the Administration on Disabilities. She was an anti-bigotry convening fellow with the Center for Anti-Racist Research at Boston University and is a former recipient of the AT&T Humanity of Connection Award. Her work has been featured in Vice, Time, The Guardian, and USA Today. Lastly, we will close the presentation with Dr. Bonnellyn Swenor, an epidemiologist and associate professor at the Johns Hopkins School of Nursing, School of Medicine, and the Bloomberg School of Public Health. She's the founder and director of the Johns Hopkins Disability Health Research Center, which aims to shift the paradigm from living with a disability to thriving with a disability through research, education, and policy. Dr. Swenor's research is motivated by her experience with disability as she has low vision. Once all of our speakers finish their presentations, we will begin our panel discussion. I would like to ask our audience to please submit your questions through the Q&A feature on Zoom, and I'll ask our panelists to wait until our discussion to answer those questions. Ben, over to you. Ben?
Hello. Let me share my presentation. I think this should work. Is that visible?
I can see it. Can anybody else see it?
Well, if it's working, I can get started then. Excuse me, I'm just, well then. Hello everyone, sorry about that delay. I'm Ben Elwy. I'm a Harvard College senior and a co-founder of the Disability Justice Club at Harvard, the student organization. My pronouns are they, he, and I'm a 21-year-old male presenting adult. Let's see. In front of a green background with brown hair and a red and black checkered shirt. So then, my perspective is someone who's experienced a story, one story that's common among disabled people, which is the feeling of living halfway in and halfway out of the world. Whether it's one step leading into a restaurant to prevent you from entering, or someone being awkward around you or infantilizing you because of your appearance. It's a common experience among disabled people through the repetition of these occurrences that there isn't anywhere in the world to belong. And it's a really important public health question to discuss how we can overcome those barriers. One approach is to work from the top down to pass legislation and policies so that promote equity, which will naturally reduce bias over time. But while I'm not an expert in any area, while I am a writer and a college student, which is a place where people come to shape and challenge their perceptions of the world. And my interest is in a bottom-up solution where we change the perception of disability in communities in order to bring to light the societal and institutional ableism that disabled people face and address them in the service of public health. To conceptualize disability justice, it's a push towards accessibility and inclusion in all forms for disabled people of all identities. And as a thought experiment, I'd like you to think of what comes to mind when you hear the phrase disabled person. We'll return to that later. In any case, it's very important to mention in this context of public health that disability justice is relevant and beneficial to everyone, not just disabled people. First, there's the aspect of universal design that disability justice promotes. For example, if you're temporarily injured and you're in crutches, you'll benefit from it. And secondly, there's a point that disability is the only minority you can join at any time, which is something we've unfortunately learned recently with the advent of long COVID, which 19% of American adults are experiencing at the moment. And of course, there's also the correlation between age and disability, meaning that disability applies to everyone. It's an issue for everyone. And so we have to tell our story and overcome that bias. Disability justice is our means to do so. And changing perceptions of disability is the end goal. And what we're changing specifically is ableism, which is a little more complicated, I think, than it's usually considered to be. On one end of the spectrum, there's discrimination, which is what you'd usually think about, subconscious bias, such as being afraid of someone or assuming that they're incompetent, similar to discrimination against other minorities. But something unique to disability on the other end of the spectrum is positive bias, but that doesn't mean good. Inspiration porn, in which disabled people are over-idolized and objectified by able people for the purpose of feeling good about themselves and avoiding the issues entirely. And so both of those are things you have to avoid, even though they look different. This is a framework provided by the American Public Health Association of 10 essential functions that public health performs. The ones that I'll be talking about most relevant to the changing perception of disability are communicating effectively about disability intersectionality, enabling equitable access for disabled people, and investigating health hazards and root causes. So returning to the frog experience from earlier, this is a screenshot I took of the top results when I searched for images about disabled person. And I imagine this is what most of you thought of as well as what I thought of. The vast majority of images here contain someone in a wheelchair. And that makes sense. It's accurate. After all, a person in a wheelchair is the symbol of disability. But while this is accurate, something like this is equally accurate. These people have no visible signs of disability and, for lack of a better word, look normal. And that's because disability is a field with several subtypes. It's not a monolith. And unfortunately, many areas go overlooked, particularly invisible and mental conditions. And it also applies to intersectionality and the question of what a disabled person looks like. You may have to think about disability and queerness, disability and race, and things along those lines. And it's relevant because people in the public health sector need to know who to look for when they're providing services. And if we have such a strict definition of disability that we only think about maybe white disabled people in wheelchairs, we're going to be overlooking many people who need help. On a similar line, enabling equitable access. As a case study, this year, Harvard's Accessible Education Office, which is the place that provides accommodations, renamed itself to the Disability Access Office, which caused confusion among students who previously received services but don't identify as disabled, because people, for example, who have severe food allergies or chronic crutches from a sports injury and are temporarily disabled thought that they no longer belonged because they don't consider themselves disabled. And ultimately, whether once you consider yourself disabled is a personal decision with no right answer, but there is a stigma against identifying disabled. A clear example of that is the phrase mental health. When we say mental health, it's a euphemism. When we say, I'm taking a mental health day, it doesn't really make sense. What we actually mean is, I'm taking a mental illness day, a mental sickness day. Mental health is a euphemism that we use to make the subject more palatable. And that's something that's pretty common in discourse across disability. We avoid the subject, and until we can make it more normalized and less stigmatized, there will be people who could identify as disabled and ask for help who won't. So we have to look at this from both the perspective of people asking for help and people receiving help. Thirdly and lastly, I think looking at this from the perspective of the perception of disability and how it goes wrong can help us identify root causes in some common health issues. For instance, social isolation, social disconnectedness and loneliness are commonly known to cause worse health outcomes. And this is especially significant in the disability community through causes such as physical inaccessibility or just general stigma and people being afraid to talk to disabled people. Then there's the lack of unified community advocacy voice. Because the disability community is so fragmented, unlike, for example, the equivalent in the queer community where there's a common identity, people in the disabled community generally identify based on their condition and not based on the disability label as a whole. And as a result, they don't have as much of a powerful voice as they could otherwise have, which came to light recently during the COVID pandemic in discussions about loosening COVID regulations from which disabled and immunocompromised people were often excluded. And finally, it's something I wish I had more time to talk about, but overemphasis of a singular model of disability, such as the social model, is also extremely harmful. Because while the social model is very important and necessary in several ways, its claim that disability is purely a societal problem and nothing inherent to a condition excludes many of the more marginalized disabled people, such as people with OCD, for instance. OCD is inherently disabling, but it's also less palatable. And so, when we exclude some disabled people at the expense of highlighting others, we're never going to advance in public health. In summary, I think progress in public health for disabled people must start at a ground level in communities, working from the bottom up, where you change perceptions of disability in order to do things such as improving communication around health issues, a bilateral communication, both people receiving help and giving help, and more rendering disability advocacy more efficient in order to facilitate change, all in the service of public health. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Ben. I believe we are now going on to Reyma. Reyma, is that how you say it?
This is Reyma. Yes, Reyma. All right, thank you, Eric, and thank you, Ben. Incredible presentation. I feel privileged to follow in your footsteps, so to speak. I myself do not have a PowerPoint, folks. You just get me for the next 8 minutes or so. Again, my name is Reyma McCoy Hyten. My pronouns are she and her. And a quick visual description of myself for those of you who are listening along is as follows. I am a biracial woman, black, white, in my early 40s. I have very curly hair. It is brown. I'm wearing heart-shaped glasses, a white turtleneck, and I'm seated in my home office with various pieces of artwork behind me. What brings me here this morning, this afternoon, this evening, today? I am an autistic person. I am a former ward of the state, and I am a child of disabled parents. My mother died in an institutional setting in 1995. I am a former direct support professional, so I've been kind of on both sides of the game, so to speak. I've also been the director of a Center for Independent Living, and as was mentioned already, in 2021, I was appointed by the Biden-Harris administration as the first Black woman to serve as the commissioner for the Administration on Disabilities. In addition to that, I've run for state legislature. I did so with the intention of creating a platform that's centered by focusing on Medicaid waivers, specifically disabled people. Additionally, I've written legislation. I've provided advisement to lawmakers, and I've engaged in extensive efforts to mobilize disabled voters, including organizing the first American Sign Language and Accessible Inclusive Caucus site in US history in 2020. I'm mentioning all of this to preface the following, which may ring provocative to some of you. There's nothing more resistant to systemic change than the system itself. Historically, what we have attempted to do under the guise of inclusion has been to create space for a population that was not taken into consideration when the system was initially built. Or if disabled people were taken into consideration, it was in the context of subordinate, not sovereign being. This is especially true for those of us who are Black and brown and disabled. That's important to keep in mind because the fact of the matter is that when a marginalized group of disabled folks, for instance, seeks to incorporate into the mainstream via the mechanism of rights, it is typically the members of the group who are able to assimilate with the greatest ease that benefit the most. In the case of disabled people, that would be white disabled people. I'm going to be very intentionally at the intersection of race and disability during my time this afternoon. So this leads to policy, legislation, and the provision of services being created with only white disabled people in mind. This in turn underpins the disability system itself. And so someone like me can't speak about systemic inequities of the mainstream without also speaking about the systemic inequities within the disabled community, omitting or not taking into consideration the needs of Black and brown people when discussing disability may not be intentional necessarily, but it is nevertheless what systemic racism in the disabled community is rooted in. And as we see in all marginalized communities that include white people, the disabled community, obviously, but also the queer community, non-Christian religious communities, women, etc., white supremacy manifests as white members ensuring that their narrative is the dominant narrative and that their needs are met first. I call it trickle-down advocacy, with the expectation that the rest of us patiently wait our turn. How many Black and brown disabled people die before it's their turn? This is the question that keeps me up at night. So, those of you who identify as being stakeholders in public health, how do you center disability when you have conversations about public health? It's an imperative that you become cognizant of the moments when you actually are having conversations about disability, albeit unwittingly. Systemic racism is a public health crisis. The public health status of the Black community in and of itself is a public health crisis. Disability permeates that public health crisis. Disparities in access to healthcare causes disability. Police violence causes disability. Racial trauma causes disability. Adverse childhood events cause disability. Unfortunately, most research that focuses on race excludes disability, and most research on disability excludes race. It's up to you and me to connect the dots and see the picture. keeping in mind that the picture of disability that emerges looks very different from preconceived notions of what disability looks like. Look behind the white man in a wheelchair and look for the middle-aged Black woman with undiagnosed post-traumatic stress disorder. Stop treating the disability community as if it's a monolith. A well-connected and wealthy white woman who uses a wheelchair and lives in a penthouse cannot speak on the experience of acquiring a disability as the result of racial trauma. Frankly, she represents a large swath of the disabled community that refuses to acknowledge that non-apparent or invisible disabilities like PTSD are even real disabilities in the first place. "It's my body that's disabled, not my mind," is a common refrain from this constituency. Where does that leave the rest of us who are not disabled in the quote unquote right way? It leaves us in the margins. For that reason, it's absolutely essential that when an entity like Boston University, for instance, is looking to create a table that is inclusive of disability, that it is doing so with the intention of selecting individuals who are disabled, Black and Brown, and at liberty to speak frankly and expansively about disability, particularly in ways that it hides in plain sight in Black and Brown communities. That said, I'm more interested in moving society to a place where the table isn't necessary, because we've reached a place where we finally commit to ensuring that no one is marginalized, and that a society that allows for even one of us to be marginalized is a society that is a failure. So I've been kind of do-si-do-ing around oppression and race and how it intersects with disability. Now, the root causes of oppression are already known. Black and Brown people have been trying to shine a light on them so that everyone can see for generations now. We have been further oppressed, even brutalized for our efforts. Anyhow, with respect, I'll say this in a general way because it's work that all academic institutions need to undertake, whether they want to or not. Academic institutions must come to terms with your role in the creation and promulgation of systemic oppression before you can even think seriously about positioning yourselves as confronters and or dismantlers of systemic oppression, such as ableism. It is humbling to face past and present transgressions, to acknowledge how an academic institution has profited off of inequity. Think of the number of universities that have the bones of indigenous and enslaved people in their collections right as we speak. Anyhow, to admit that ultimately, as you've engaged in scholarly analysis of the problem in a meta sense, you've simultaneously been a driving force in its forward momentum, you in a general sense, of course. All of this requires language that can feel very unfamiliar to academics, including, "I don't know, my education didn't prepare me for this," and perhaps maybe academia should take a supporting rather than a leading role in this work. Now, as we all know, we recently wrapped up midterm elections, and maybe many of you are wondering what you should be watching for in, with regards to the health and protections of disabled people in the US. And I should probably say something about Medicaid waiver funded home and community-based services, which have been mentioned a few times already, or electronic visit verification, also known as EVV, which is a technology that's used to ensure that home-based services are being provided. But I'll say this, thanks to the systemic racism that pervades the disabled community, as fraught with issues as HCBS is, and as intrusive as EVV is, look up EVV if you are unsure what that is, Black and Brown disabled people wouldn't know, because the massive disparities in access to Medicaid waivers like HCBS that exist. and are exacerbated by the disabled community itself. Anyhow, I am constantly urging disabled people to pay close attention to how our lives are impacted by the parts of the political process that are at play, no matter what the results are of any particular election day. Disability intersects with more issues than HCBS. One of the reasons why I think that disabled people struggle to gain visibility by the mainstream is because the disability community is so insular in its focus. Its focus being ensuring that the needs of middle-class white disabled people are met, and in spite of demanding equality, rights, et cetera, largely refuses to explore how disability intersects with issues that extend beyond the needs of what it considers to be its base. For instance, family separations at the southern border are ongoing and creating a generation of shell-shocked immigrants from Latin America and Haiti. Remember that trauma can be a precursor to disability. With that in mind, setting immigrants up to be tortured, except outside of the US, is a thing that's happening. Refrigerating surplus corpses of immigrants in border cities. Title 42, which allows authorities to quickly expel most immigrants. A stay was actually issued with regards to Title 42 a few weeks ago. Lack of meaningful and updated federal protection for voting rights, which impacts Black people, disabled people, and of course, Black disabled people. Lack of federal level law enforcement accountability. Police violence, again, is a public health crisis. Continued vulnerability of reproductive autonomy. Forced sterilization is still legal in 31 United US states, by the way. The possible ending of the Indian Child and Welfare Act, which would further impact the mental health and well-being of Indigenous people in the United States. The continued pathologization and criminalization of Black people, particularly Black disabled people, who are basically issued a one-way ticket to on the preschool to prison pipeline during childhood. Criminal justice reform is a disability justice issue. Zero federal protections for transgender people. 30% of transgender people are disabled in the United States. The exploitation of personal care attendants and direct support professionals who are providing Medicaid-funded services, including HCBS, the majority of whom, 6 out of 10, are Black and Brown people and are not paid living wages, may or may not receive benefits like health insurance, are subjected to unsafe working conditions, as we saw during the early days of the pandemic, and are subjected to racist abuse from their employers and the aging and disabled clients they provide services to. Not much of that is going to change because of the midterms, and staying informed and on top of all of this stuff could easily be a full-time job. Multiply marginalized disabled people are too busy getting clobbered by the system to stay on top of all of this stuff, nor should they, or anyone who isn't being compensated for their efforts be expected to do so, not in a functional system. In closing, I'd like to note the passing of Ms. Lois Curtis, who along with Elaine Wilson and their attorney, Sue Jameson, were the plaintiffs in what's known as the Olmstead decision, a US Supreme Court ruling that affirmed that disabled people have the right to live in the least restrictive environment possible. Both Lois, a Black woman, and Elaine, a white woman, spent their lives in and out of institutions against their will. The Olmstead decision theoretically removes significant barriers to them living in the community. But I say theoretically because although Elaine would go on to live in the community after Olmstead, Lois, unfortunately, continued to experience periods of institutionalization. Ultimately, the Olmstead decision addressed structural barriers to community living that stemmed from disability, but often falls short when it comes to Black and Brown disabled people. Lois died recently and was so poor that were it not for a fundraiser created on her behalf. There would have been no money for her funeral. May she rest in power and never be forgotten. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, Reyma, thank you. Reyma, sorry. Thank you very much for that. Finally, we have Bonnie Swenor. So Bonnie, I think just the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. I'm really honored to be having this opportunity today and to be speaking with among this great panel and following Reema's powerful conversation and a critically important conversation is certainly a high order. So I will do my best. So for my visual description, I am a blonde-haired, white, middle-aged woman. I am sitting in my office in Baltimore, Maryland, and I use she, her pronouns. I am a disabled woman. I have low vision, and I am a public health professional. I am an epidemiologist by training. And so I come to this conversation from multiple sides of the equation, having this experience, working in public health, going through training in public health. And so I wanted to start my part of the discussion today with just defining what is public health. And the American Public Health Association defines public health as efforts to promote and protect the health of people and communities where they live, learn, work, and play. And over the past many years, and certainly during the pandemic, this work has sharpened focus on health equity, something we've already talked about in this conversation today. And that focus on health equity has certainly ignited important discussions about just what health equity is. How do we measure it? What do we need to do to achieve it? How do we define it? The CDC defines health equity as the point when everyone has the opportunity to be as healthy as possible. And while that might be an oversimplified definition, it underscores the idea that health equity is all about the pursuit of improving access to the things, resources, opportunities to be healthy. There's a heavy emphasis on that equity part, but what we don't spend enough time considering is the health part. In many ways, our current structures of public health and health equity uphold what is really a hierarchical concept of health, where there's more value assigned to the lives of people who meet some criteria of what we think of as healthy. This value is so powerful that it has become a surrogate for the total value of somebody's life. But what does that really mean for people that don't fit current views of what healthy is? For example, people with disabilities, people with chronic conditions, people like me. We see this perplexing idea getting played out in so many ways across public health. Concepts like disability-adjusted life years, which is built on ableist ideas that people with disabilities inherently have less valuable lives. If we truly want to make public health progress, it's time for public health to call into question our basic ideas of health. And let me be very clear, I do not believe, and I am not stating, that the pursuit of health is the problem. Instead, it's the way in which we conceive of health, that hierarchy of health, that needs to be re-examined. And it's that struggle with that concept of health that to me is so central to centering public health on the disability community. And that deeper look at how we imagine health and that hierarchy of health matters because disability is so common, already has been discussed today. In the US, there's 67 million adults with disabilities. This is the latest prevalence estimates from my center from 2019. It's equating to 27% of adults are one in four of us. Around the world, there's about 1 billion disabled people, or 15% of the global population, that has a disability. What that means is that people with disabilities are the largest minority group, statement already made, and people with disabilities are part of all of our communities. What that means is the ways in which we view, include, research, discuss disabled people matters. It matters because disabled people account for such a large percentage of our population, of all of our populations, all of our communities. And although disability is so common, health inequities remain unaddressed for this population, remain deprioritized in public health. The pursuits of addressing health equity or health inequities for disabled people has been ignored for too long. There's a view that, of course, disabled people have quote unquote worse health inequities. They're disabled. But that's the exact kind of thinking that we have to question in public health. On this slide, I'm showing data from a landmark paper by Gloria Cron and colleagues that was really critical in starting a shift among at least some of us in thinking about people with disabilities as a population that faces health disparities. So this slide is a bar graph of the results from that work, and it's showing that a higher percentage of people with disabilities are smokers, a lower percentage engage in physical activity, yet a greater percentage of people with disabilities have cardiovascular disease and are obese. And people with disabilities are more likely to not get the healthcare they need because of medical costs, and a higher percentage of women with disabilities are not getting mammograms and pap tests. But these data really are just a snapshot of the health inequities that people with disabilities face. But as mentioned earlier in this conversation, it's not just about those end health inequities, it's the social determinants of health that also matter, and there's inequities with those too. So on this slide, our bar graph results from work out of my center showing that as compared to people without disabilities, a higher percentage of adults with disabilities have less than a high school education, have a household income of less than $25,000 per year, and a higher percentage of people with disabilities are unemployed. And as was just very importantly discussed, we cannot do this work without considering the importance of intersectionality and the difference of experiences that disabled people have, not just across the spectrum of disability by people with different types of disabilities, which is absolutely important to consider, but also examining these inequities for people with disabilities from other intersecting oppressed groups, such as individuals from racial, ethnic, gender, and sexual minority populations. So on this slide, I'm showing data from our group showing some of those disparities across those intersections, and that education, income, and employment have greater disparities across all those areas for people with disabilities who are Hispanic and Black. And that's critical to consider because if you're looking at just one dimension, you miss part of that whole picture. So what does all this mean for this bigger conversation about recentering public health on the disability community? Well, to me, I think what it means is we have some work to do. We have work that will, quite frankly, make many of us feel uncomfortable as public health professionals. We have work that must challenge deeply everything that society teaches people about what disability is, particularly when it comes to public health. While that may seem like a heavy lift to push against the current norm, it is a critical one in achieving health equity for everyone in our communities. It's one that honestly isn't too dissimilar than other types of critical introspection that public health is taking on right now. So how do we start? How do we, as a field of public health, go about this? So I propose really three initial actions to help with that process. It's about reframing, relearning, and redefining. And so reframing is thinking deeply about how disability has been conceptualized in public health. There is a need to understand disability, study disability, and talk about disability based on the views of disabled people. Within our community, there's a shift from the medical model of disability, where disability is defined by the presence of an impairment or disease and focuses largely on correcting disabilities, to a social model where disability is conceived as a social construct like race, ethnicity, gender identity, and there is a focus on addressing ableism, environmental barriers, and the societal exclusion that people with disabilities face and keep us out of full participation in society. But as Ben very clearly discussed, there's some discussion among which is the right model. And to be honest, there's many more models than just the medical and social. But the issue is that currently, public health, medicine, and most of research solely relies on a medical model, which is not informed by the disability community. And over the past few years, what we have learned is that our work is most impactful, most powerful when we center our approaches on the views of the communities that we serve, on the views of those who are most impacted. And for people with disabilities, that's really no different. We also need to relearn about disability in this process of centering public health on the disability community. We need to unlearn in lots of ways what society has taught us about disability. Society has reinforces largely incorrect and negative stereotypes. We need, as public health professionals and as society writ large, to understand and accept that disabled people themselves are experts in the experience of disability. You don't need a PhD to be an expert in disability. Living that life makes you an expert. It also will take a full and public recognition by public health professionals and leaders that ableism is among one of the most formidable threats to health equity and all pursuits of public health. It also will take a deep understanding and recognition that equity for our society is truly impossible until disabled people are included. People with disabilities, again, are in all of our communities, making that so critical. Relatedly, too often disability is excluded from the important intersectional public health and health equity efforts. Reyma described some of this, and that practice really cannot continue. And redefining health is also a critical dimension. We need to take a very hard look at how we think about health. While the pursuit of health, again, is not in question, we need to understand and challenge those ableist underpinnings of how we conceive of health and that hierarchy we assign to health that devalues people's lives. I want to again elevate the great work of Gloria Cron and her colleagues who recently published a paper just about this topic, challenging the notions of health and the ableism that it upholds. In this paper, they propose a new definition of health, that is a dynamic balance of well-being and adapting to conditions of life and the environment. I encourage you all to review and read this paper. It really is excellent in thinking through this concept. And I want to end with a core idea about public health process. No matter what area you're working in, no matter the topic, it really has been slowed because disabled people have been left out, left behind. And to move public health forward, we need to include disabled people in all aspects and areas of our work, and not just reserving disability inclusion for those quote unquote disability areas, issues, topics. All issues are disability issues. This also means, as as was also discussed, it's duty elevated, that we need more disabled public health leaders, researchers, professionals, students, trainees. We need to make sure that that change happens. We need to forge meaningful relationships with the disability community. And it really is far past time for public health to make this change and to do this work. I'm gonna end there with just a plug for my own center. You can learn more on our website about the work we do, which is squarely in this space, disabilityhealth.jhu.edu.
Thank you very much, Bonnie, Reyma, Ben. I really appreciated all your presentations. I just want to begin. We're running short on time, but I want to continue some questions. But I want to begin some questions that really, I think, kind of to really jump off these points. All of you represent really important factions. Ben, you're a young person, and you've really tried to create accessibility on campus. Reyma, you've talked a lot about intersectionality. Bonnie, you talked a lot about from the public health sector. I think one of the things that's important to recognize is that public health as a practice is A, fairly new, and B, from the beginning, didn't include people with disabilities. So I think what I want to know and how I can and how I begin this conversation is how do you include people with disabilities? And then B, how do people with disabilities navigate a field that is really important like public health that didn't have them in mind? And how do we do that kind of unlearning that Bonnie and Reyma discussed? Anybody can answer.
I don't know if my fellow panelists want to chime in, but such a really important question. And it reminds me of the prior conversation with Judy about sustainability and not burning out. It's something I feel often. You know, there's sort of this strange juxtaposition of continuing the journey of having a disability and being more secure with that identity and learning about who you are. And I think that never ends. And also fighting a system that really was, to your point, Eric, built to exclude and keep you out, even if it might have been unintentional. It's hard, you know, it feels like you don't belong in every aspect of that. And you're erased. And I wish I had an easy answer, except I think there needs to be conversations like this, more conversations like this, with more diverse perspectives on this topic. And we need to focus on the next generation and including more disabled students from a variety of backgrounds in public health to really lead that change.
Anybody have anything to say?
This is Reyma, and I'll just say, I think that for folks that are multiply marginalized, many of us feel like we're beyond having the conversations or that we don't have the luxury of time to have conversations. And so oftentimes when we're invited to participate in conversations, we have to kind of weigh, you know, should I participate in this conversation, because that's going to take me away from actually doing the work. And so I think that that's an important thing to keep in mind. When we're wanting to be inclusive, we're wanting to ensure that there are lots of voices at the table. The fact that many of us have been shut out of these conversations so long, we have kind of moved on. Maybe as important as the proverbial table is, keeping that in mind and figuring out ways that you can join us as we're out on, you know, on the streets doing the work and allow for you to learn that way, as opposed to inviting us to sit at the table to theoretically learn something that we have a lot of experiential understanding of already.
Do you have anything to say?
I think I agree with everything that was said. To provide more of a basic answer, this was partially touched upon already. I'd say that while there are short-term solutions, such as was mentioned, providing someone a seat at a table for a conversation or two, those are only short-term solutions and don't particularly have much of a long-term effect. The efforts in this area to increase diversity in public health and to incorporate disabled voices into public health needs to be a long-term process that focuses on the next generation. And an important part of that is not just increasing diversity in public health, but increasing diversity with disabled people in general. That is fixing the pipeline of education and ensuring that disabled people have the support to get to higher education in the first place.
This is Judy, if I could jump in.
By all means, you have the floor, ma'am.
I think it really is essential that a review of the courses in general that are being taught in schools is analyzed to see how disability needs to be integrated, particularly in the area of public health. Because a lot of this is about learning. And I think, obviously, people go to graduate school, undergraduate school, postdoc, because they're learning more in the area of public health, whatever their field may be. And there's a value of learning. But if you are consistently not learning about disability and everything else we've been discussing, I think people don't necessarily know where to begin. The teams that they may be working on may not have learned the same types of information, may not want to include it unless you're able to substantiate why it's important. So I think we need to look in our own backyard at schools of public health and look at both people who have graduated, students, look at what's working, what's not working, and get a group of universities committed to making substantial changes so that disability is not something that may be taught as a part of public health in one or two schools.
Thank you. On top of that, there was a really interesting question that was in the chat. Which is, so somebody asked, I believe it was Carrie Sesportis, and forgive me if I'm butchering your name. I think there was a question of, I wish there were more time to talk about how those of us who are disabled public health professionals can successfully navigate the barriers in our workplaces. While we are slim on time, I was wondering if anybody had any suggestions anybody wanted to discuss this, because this is really important that we have figures in there, but we also, you know, how do you navigate those? You know, Bonnie, you talked a little bit about this, but floor is open to anybody.
Is she able to speak?
Yes, I believe so. Carrie, can you speak? Can you speak, or are you allowed to speak?
Eric, the webinar participants can speak. You only.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. I mean, so the question was, how do public health professionals navigate, who are disabled, successfully navigate the barriers in your own workspaces, just in your own experiences? Anybody can speak on this.
I mean, I think there are a number of ways of looking at this. One is literally navigating. If you have certain types of disabilities where various forms of accessibility are required, are they in fact being easily offered? And then there's the other issue, which I think we've all been speaking to in one way or the other. What is it that needs to be changing? And what ways are the person asking the question and others finding receptivity and being able to implement numbers of the things we've been discussing?
I'll weigh in very quickly. I know we're over time, but I always advise community, community, community. Even if those individuals aren't local where you are, your institution and your public health department, find other disabled colleagues in the field of public health, and their strength in numbers.
I mean, I agree with that, but I think it's about leadership too. I think too frequently we're putting it back on the community. And obviously I'm not speaking about excluding the community. They must be a part of what's happening, but we can look at community as the faculty and the students in schools of public health, and how are they being included? How is their voice, how are their voices being requested to participate? I think those are really some of the issues working within the community outside of schools of public health. Obviously, are the majority of people we're going to work with, but I think deans of the schools of public health need to be really seen as having interest in, experience in many of the issues that we've been discussing, and need to be able to be seen publicly. You know, when you look at the Ford Foundation as an example, Ford has over the last number of years put both money and some staffing into addressing issues both within the organization and external to the organization, within the organization to get the staff of the organization to understand disability more by bringing a diverse group of consultants into work, but likewise putting funding aside that's focused on underrepresented populations of people to be able to get money to build organizations and in many ways help advance public health related problems. But I think we need to be looking at disability in schools of public health like we are in areas of race and gender, as an example. And we do not see that in the same way.
I believe, unfortunately, I would love for this to continue, but I believe we are out of time. So I want to thank everybody who participated in this discussion. This has been fantastic. I want to thank BUSPH for inviting me to moderate. This has been a fantastic discussion. So thank you very much to everybody.
Let me just jump in to echo to say thank you. Thank you not only to the panelists and to the moderator, but to the participants who were immensely engaged, both in terms of questions and in terms of the chat. I just want to echo what Ms. Heumann and Judy said at the end, which is, we host this conversation as a way of investing in both the next generation, which is the students, many of whom are actually on a conversation like this, but in trying to carve a path forward within public health. And I have learned tremendously from all of you. And for us, the challenge is how we incorporate a lot of the elements that you have so eloquently put forward into the work that we do. I think, Judy, you mentioned about how thinking about disability justice in the same lens as we're thinking about racial justice and social justice, which are very much, they have been core elements and increasingly core elements of public health thinking, both in practice and in academic public health. But disability justice is not, and figuring out how to incorporate that. If we can do that, it seems to me like it will have been well worth the conversation.
I mean, it's in many ways, it's self-evident. You know, if you look at issues like violence against women, and you look at issues of violence against disabled girls and women, you'll see that data collected on disabled girls and women has been collected for many fewer years than in the area for non-disabled women. But you also need to recognize, one, that many women who have experienced sexual assault, who may not have had a disability prior to that experience, may now have a disability, both physically, mentally, whatever. And the failure to be able to put a disability lens on an issue like this not only means that you're not appropriately addressing women who had disabilities already, but you're not addressing issues of women who've acquired disabilities. You're not addressing issues of shelters where women may be going if they've experienced violence, and whether those shelters are accessible, whether those shelters are serving women who are deaf or blind or have an intellectual disability, mental health disability, or physical disability. There are so many areas here which I think could be learning experiences, the how to put a disability lens on other work. And violence to me is such an obvious one.
Thank you. You know, just say one last thing, and I'm aware of the time, and I want to respect everybody's time. It's I believe strongly that a core part of the job of academic public health, which is sort of the institution where we sit, is to help move the lenses through which we can see the world forward. And Judy, you used this term lens, so I really appreciate that. And I think recognizing, seeing a disability lens and trying to incorporate it, make it part of the core essence of what public health does, could be a real contribution to moving the world forward in its own way. And as a complement to all the other work that Reyma talked about very well, is actually happening in advocacy and other areas. This is one area that can complement all of these. I'm really grateful to all of you for surfacing that. Judy, thank you. Bonnie, Ben, Reyma, Eric, and Eric, thank you for giving us the time and engaging with this. And more importantly, thank you for what you do every day in all your spaces. To all the participants who engaged, thank you for being with us today. Everybody, have a good afternoon, a good evening, and a good morning, depending where you are in the world. Take good care, everybody.
Thank you.